Good morning. Welcome to Harrisville Baptist Church. We're so glad and happy and delighted to see all your smiling and pretty faces here this morning. If y'all would, please stand, go shake a hand, and finish help us singing this song.
Would you be free from your burden of sin? There's fire in the blood, fire in the blood. Would you or evil a victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in that precious blood of the Lamb. Hi, guys. From your passion and pride, there's power in the blood, power in the blood. Come for a cleansing to Calvary's tide, there's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in that precious blood of the Lamb. Well, would you do service for Jesus your King? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you live daily as praises to sing? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in that precious blood of the Lamb.
Amen. Give God a hand. All righty. Y'all may be seated.
Lead us and direct us, Lord. Lord, we come to you today, Lord, with a sad heart. This young man, Lord, that we know, Jonathan, we pray for him and his family as they go through this trying time in their life. Many in our church, Lord, Wayne Lemon's family, Lord, we pray for them, lift them up to you, Lord, today. Lord, we ask that you continue to give them strength and guidance, Lord, and a heart. You know, only that you can make peace. Lord, we pray that you continue to be with our world leaders, Lord, today as we go through situations that we've never faced before. Lord, I pray that you continue to give them the wisdom and the guidance that they need, Lord, to make the decisions they need to make. Lord, our community is just hurting today, Lord, many various reasons, Lord. Many are going through sickness and health problems. Lord, we continue to pray for them. And Lord, we ask that you lay your healing hand upon them, Lord, and bring them back to their place of service. Lord, I ask that you forgive us of our many shortcomings, our sins. Lord, we pray that you continue to give us guidance and wisdom. All these things we ask in Christ's name. Amen.
I'm pressing on on the upward way, new heights I've gained. And in every day, still praying as I onward bound, Lord, plant my feet on that higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's tableland, a higher plane that I have found. Lord, plant my feet on that higher ground. My heart has no desire to stay, but doubts arise and fears dismay. But some may dwell where these abound. My prayer, my aim is for higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's table and a higher plane that I have found. Lord, plant my feet on that higher ground. I want to scale the utmost heights and catch a gleam of glory bright. But still I pray to Him I found. Lord, lead me on to that higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's table and a higher plane that I have found. Lord, plant my feet on that higher ground, the higher plane that I have found. Lord, plant my feet on that higher ground.
Amen.
There's nothing worth more that would ever come close. Nothing can compare your our living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, when my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. In your presence, Lord, Holy Spirit, you are welcome.
Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, there's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare your our living hope, your presence, Lord. And I've tasted my heart becomes free, and my shame is under your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord. And Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord.
Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness.
Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord.
Amen. Give God a hand. All righty. If y'all would, please stand for our last.
Lord, I come, I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. Without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you.
Grace is more, grace is found, is where you are.
And where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. And where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. Lord, I need you. sins, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you.
So teach my song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, and when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. So teach my song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. And every hour I need you. Oh, my one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. Oh, I need you. And every hour I need you. You're my one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you.
Amen. Y'all may be seated. The Lord, we need you. In the good times, Lord, and in the bad, Lord, there's Brother Randy prayed a while ago, God, there's a lot of stuff going on. There's a lot of stuff going on that we don't understand, God, but you do. There's a lot of stuff going on, God, that we can't fix, but Lord, you can. And I pray, Lord, that you just put a special hand on those going through loss, those going through heartache, those going through sickness. God, you're the great physician, God, and we pray, Lord, that your will be done. Lord, I pray everybody's prayer this morning is just to know you, just to want to know you, just to need you. God, we love you and we thank you that we're able to meet here today. Lord, I pray, Lord, that we can go out and show others, God, Lord, that just how awesome you are. In your name we pray. Amen.
Walked on the water. He calmed the wind. was about to say, either you were here and are too tired to clap, or you know someone who was here and you're afraid to clap because it might wake them up. Boy, what a great week of VBS we had. We're so thankful for Miss Jill and for Miss Kathy and for all the workers that we had that worked so hard in the weeks and months leading up to VBS, and certainly last week, every night this past week, just having a great time. Had a lot of kids come in and to hear the word of Jesus and to learn more about him and to understand that God's with us no matter what, especially this weekend as we have lost one that we love so dearly, Mr. Wayne Lemon, as we grieve his loss, but are thankful that he is far better off than he's ever been. And also even now, as we pray fervently for little Justin. Boy, in those times we start to realize, you know, we talk about twists and turns, but we live them, don't we? We go through them. Just got word that they were doing the next test for Justin, and I know many of you have been praying for him. He was involved in a pool incident over the weekend, and is fighting for his life now. So I'd like to take just a moment before we share the word with you, and let's go to the Lord in prayer for Justin and for the Bynum family. So would you pray with me? And you're welcome to pray out loud, even as I do as well. Father God, we come to you, Lord, now just knowing and trusting that you are the Lord of all things. God, you have power over everything. There's nothing beyond your reach. There's nothing beyond the power that you and you alone have. Lord God, right now, no matter what this test may say, Lord, would you wrap up the Bynum family? Father God, we pray, Lord, that if it be your will, you would miraculously bring healing, Father, and recuperation to Justin. Lord God, if that's not what your will is, Father, as much as we will grieve, as much as we will hurt, would you help us, Lord, to trust you no matter what? Father God, would you wrap that family up in your loving arms? Would you bring them strength, comfort, peace in such tumultuous and tragic times? Lord God, we know, Father, that you know far better than us. We don't know what's ahead of us. We don't even know fully what we've gone through in the past or what we're going through right now. But Lord, you know it all. So Lord, would you be with this family, the community that has impacted so much, as we continue to lift up Justin and his family with you. Father God, would you work as only you can and help us to trust you, and Lord, help us to learn to be able to glorify you, even when we don't understand. Father, we love you. Lord, would you speak now through your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. This morning we continue in the Found Freedom sermon series, working our way through the book of Galatians. It's not often when you're preaching through a book that you have the benefit of when you have a very weighty chapter like chapter 2, that the last sermon of the last sermon series was a lot of chapter 2 of Galatians. And God took care of that so that we could get it all in on a Sunday morning here. And so we're going to skip a little bit in Galatians chapter 2. We'll talk about it as we get there. But if you were here a couple weeks ago, you got to hear about Galatians 2, at least the bulk of the middle of it or so. But this morning, we pick up in the beginning of Galatians chapter 2, and this letter that Paul wrote to this church spread out over many local churches in the region of Galatia, a region that he had been active and was active as a missionary and as an apostle in, where he had planted many of these churches. He had certainly nurtured most of these churches and grown to know their people and serve with them and do amazing ministry in sharing the gospel to the Gentiles. Now, if you remember from last week in Galatians chapter 1, you remember that there's a problem that he's addressing. And he gets right to it in Galatians chapter 1. We mentioned that last week in the sermon. But what the problem is that Galatia is a part of the world where it's more populated by non-Jewish people, Gentiles, than it is by Jewish people. It's not Jerusalem, it's not Judea, it's not the nation of Israel. That's not where it is. It's moved off further into the Roman Empire towards modern-day Turkey, actually in modern-day Turkey. And so Paul and his mission, as God has given it to him, is ministering the gospel of Jesus to the Gentiles and telling them that they can be set free from the bondage of sin, from the bondage of judgment. They can be set free by putting their faith in Jesus. The same gospel that you and I hear today, that we'll present even from this very stage in this very sermon. The same gospel, I hope, that you, if you've put your faith in Christ, that you heard when you put your faith in Christ. And that is the gospel that God gave to Paul and that he was faithful to share. The problem came when there were people who were of Jewish descent, Jewish background, Jewish expertise, that said that, hey, look, this Jesus came from us. it came from our faith of Judaism. And yes, he's doing a new thing, but if you're going to be part of that new thing, these people, the Judaizers as they were called, would say this, you got to be Jewish first. It doesn't mean that you can't become Jewish. If Gentiles became faithful to the Jewish faith all the time, but they had to do some things. They had to adhere by the law. The men had to be circumcised, no matter what age they were. And this was being taught as a prerequisite for salvation through Christ. And Paul, of course, saw this as a problem. And I think we understand today that it was a problem. God had come to fulfill the law in Christ, not to have the law continue to rule over and to be above what Christ brings and what Christ does. And so for them to say, well, yeah, you can put your faith in Jesus, but you've also got to do these Jewish things according to the law, that was giving the law more power than it needed to have. And so Paul writes this letter to talk to the Galatian churches, to talk to the people that made up the Galatian churches, and to tell them, look, it's not about all these things that we do. It is about who we put our faith in. It's about who we trust with our lives, who we give our lives over to and begin to pattern our lives after under His power and through His Holy Spirit. It's about Jesus. And that's the freedom that we find in Him, is that He doesn't hold us to the old ways of doing things. He has set us free. And when we are set free in Him, our life will start to line up with the things that matter the most, the things that are in accordance with who Jesus is and what His Word says. That was the problem, though. The people were saying, yeah, okay, we get that, but you also have to do this. You know, we could say Jesus plus nothing. That's been a former sermon series years ago now, I think. Jesus plus nothing, and that's a good thing to remember in the message that is talking about that found freedom in the book of Galatians is we don't need to be anything other than faithful to Jesus to live in that freedom, to find that freedom, and to experience that freedom, and to glorify God in that freedom. Now, towards the end of chapter 1, Paul made a very big point to say that, look, the gospel that he preaches, the gospel of Jesus Christ, didn't come to him through some people. It didn't come to him because some other people said this is what to say. He was an apostle because Jesus met him face to face on the road to Damascus that day, as we read in Acts chapter 9. Met him right there and changed his life and gave him that message to share with everyone, Jew or Gentile alike. And his ministry largely became to predominantly Gentiles because they were being left out or they were being told a different gospel, another gospel, as he says in chapter 1. So Paul's putting out his defense to make sure people know that the gospel that he's talking about, the gospel that you and I understand today that comes from his faithful preaching of it and from God's sharing of it throughout the years since, that gospel tells us that it's all about Jesus, and it comes directly from God. And so we pick up in the middle of that argument, that defense of Paul, of the gospel he preaches, and he's going to give some allusion to some events that happen that we can read about in the book of Acts and line up, and it's pretty awesome how God's Word, you know, so often we think about it, this book or that book, but they all tie together. They all share with us the truth, and they corroborate one another as God's Word should. And we can find great, hopefully great trustworthiness in the fact that they do connect. It's not just this person, Paul writing here, or Peter writing there, or James writing over here, or Moses writing even before them. No, it's God giving us what we need to know about Him. Paul continues his defense of his preaching of the gospel that God gave him in Galatians chapter 2, verse 1. And he says this. He says, then, after 14 years, I went up again to Jerusalem, this time with Barnabas. I took Titus along also. I went in response to a revelation, and meeting privately with those esteemed as leaders, I presented to them the gospel that I preach among the Gentiles. I wanted to be sure I was not running and had not been running my race in vain. Yet not even Titus, who was with me, was compelled to be circumcised, even though he was a Greek. This matter arose because some false believers had infiltrated our ranks to spy on the freedom we have in Christ Jesus and to make us slaves. But we did not give in to them for a moment so that the truth of the gospel might be preserved for you. He's telling the Galatian churches this. He's telling them that, look, the gospel that you're hearing from me, you need to stick with that, not because it comes from Paul, but because it comes from God. And so he's giving them this historical account to back that up so that he can reiterate to them that this is what God's doing, not just what some apostles are doing, or not what some other apostles are doing or other leaders are doing back in Jerusalem where this all got started. It's not about the people doing it. It's about the God of the people who's doing it in and through the people. And what he's telling us here is he's saying all this to remind us how important it is that our change must be right. We left off last week. The last point of the sermon was is that the gospel has the power to change. And so we come to God and we ask Him to save us. We put our faith in Jesus. We accept the gospel and He makes us a new creation, as we talked about for several weeks not too long ago. And we do that and He begins to grow us and change us and strengthen us and build us up in ways we never even imagined, and to take down some of the things that used to be so familiar to us and let us do away with them, to crucify those and to live that new life that He's given us. But when we do that, sometimes when we're living our Christian life, God's changing us. And sometimes we even get past that fear of change and we start to change a lot of things. But we always want to make sure of one very important thing, that our change must be right. And what I mean by that this morning is our change has to be not just stuff we think we should change, not just stuff I think I should change about me, or you think I should change about me, or vice versa. But it has to be in accordance with this gospel that comes from God. You see, because if we change in ways, if we do the things we do just because we think we should, and we're not paying attention to what God commands us and what God saves us and what God empowers us to do, well, then we're calling it salvation, but we may be living something totally different. We have to make sure our change is right. So what is Paul talking about here? There's a lot of things that go on. He said 14 years later, this is after he had gone to Jerusalem, met with the apostles there, just a few of them, and then was taken off to his home city of Tarsus and then began to minister. So 14 years later, and we read about this, we believe, in Acts chapter 11 at the end, where he talks about taking an offering to Jerusalem to support the churches there. So there's brotherhood, there's sister church relationship going on here, there's mutual support of ministry all over, especially when dealing with ministering to the poor. But he goes back 14 years later when he does this, when he brings that offering to the church at Jerusalem to be distributed out through that area. He takes it back. He says, I went up to Jerusalem, and this time with Barnabas. Now, what do we know about Barnabas? Barnabas is the one who, when he first came to Jerusalem, he vouched for Paul. Paul, at that point, as we read at the end of chapter 1, was the guy who used to persecute the church and now is preaching. The guy who used to be against us and now is leading us. The guy who used to be one to fear and now is one to listen to and to respect and to be ministered to by. And he says the church there, the people, the believers there, praised God because of this. A lot of that was made possible by the encourager, Barnabas, who said, yes, I believe, I see what's going on in this man's life, and I believe this is God working. Barnabas was led by God, inspired by God, empowered by God to vouch for Paul so that he would be accepted in that church in Jerusalem. And so when he comes back, he brings Barnabas with him, a point of familiar faces. And he says he also brought Titus with him. Now, Titus is not Jewish. Barnabas was. Titus was not. Titus is a Greek. He was not born and raised up in the Jewish tradition. In this particular instance, the most important thing here, other than him being a Gentile, specifically was he wasn't circumcised. And he brings that up in just a moment. In verse 2, he says, I went in response to a revelation. Remember the defense. Remember the point of the argument that he's making here. What he's telling the churches at Galatia and in and around that region is that, look, I'm not doing this for men's approval, for people's approval. I'm not doing this because I've been sent by people. I'm doing this, I preach what I preach because it's been given to me by God, and I've been sent by God, and I'm on a mission for God. And so what he's telling them here is, look, I went in response to revelation. God called Paul to go to Jerusalem, to not only share that offering, but also to have what we would find out would be the opportunity to continue to defend and to glorify God in the explanation of the ministry that he has been given by God, that he's being faithful to. And he says, meeting privately with those esteemed as leaders. So we're not talking about a huge, you know, massive gathering. We're not talking about some of the many hearings and trials that go on throughout the book of Acts and throughout the first century there in Jerusalem. What we're talking about here is he's meeting with some of the apostles. He's meeting with the ones who are, as he says, esteemed as leaders. Is it all apostles? Well, probably not. In fact, we find out that there's more people in there than that. But he's meeting with the ones who are the most important people in the ministry there. And that doesn't mean that they're better than anybody else, but they're the leaders, right? He's going to the deacons' meeting, so to speak. Boy, that's a very loose interpretation, by the way. No offense, deacons, but we're not quite there, right? And pastor's not quite there either. Don't worry about that. That's not what I'm saying. But again, he's going to a meeting of the leaders, right? He's going to the ones who make decisions, who have been a part of all this, and who have interest in knowing this gospel that is being preached, that their hearing is different from theirs, and that Paul knows that vice versa, the gospel that's coming supposedly under their authority is different than the one he's preaching. He says he met privately with those esteemed as leaders. He says, I presented to them the gospel that I preach among the Gentiles. Now, one thing we know about Paul is, we know this through the book of Acts, we know it through his epistles, his letters that we read throughout the New Testament. We know when Paul stood up before those leaders to preach the gospel that God had given to him to share with the world, he didn't pull any punches. He was not trying to impress them. He was not trying to win their approval. He simply was faithful in what he was supposed to preach everywhere. He preached it right there. He was no different there than he was in the churches in Galatia or the church at Ephesus or the church at Antioch or anywhere else. He preached the truth of the gospel as best he understood it directly from the Lord. He preached to them. This is not they wanted to come and see his shtick. This was not they wanted to come and see his sideshow. They want to know, what are you saying to these people? And he said it. He didn't hide anything. He didn't color code it. He didn't sweep anything under the rug. He simply preached the gospel. And so when he says, I presented to them the gospel that I preached to the Gentiles, that's exactly what he did. Latter part of verse 2, he said, I wanted to be sure I was not running and had not been running my race in vain. And this speaks, I believe, this part of this verse speaks directly to the point of this part of the passage. He said, I wanted to make sure that I wasn't running and that I had not been running my race in vain. What was Paul's race? Paul's race, as he would describe it, and as he would use a physical race to illustrate it, was the running out, the living out of the life that God had called him to. When he talks about running his race, what he's saying here is he's making sure that we understand that this is what his illustration for life in Christ is. And what he wants to be sure of here, not to win the apostles' approval, he's not trying to say, okay, good, if I preach good enough for them to like me, then they'll vote and everything will be okay. No, that's not it. He wasn't preaching in a way to impress them. What he was doing was trying to be honest and obedient to the Lord, so that the Lord, through his action in those people's hearts, would give validation and assurance of his righteousness in his mission. And so what Paul does, he says it, and he says, look, I want to be sure that I wasn't running and had not been running my race in vain. What would have looked like if he had been running his race in vain? Here's what I believe. Now, again, there's a lot of debate about this, right? But in looking at it, this is what I believe. I believe with all my heart that Paul wanted to see the true gospel that had been given to him by God be accepted by the church. Not just by the leaders of the church, not just by the people who were new, who were being evangelized, but by the whole church. The newest believers, the ones that would become believers, and the ones that had been there since the first disciples were called, some of which were present in this time. He says, I wanted to make sure I wasn't running my race in vain. To him, if him preaching the gospel and their reaction started to cause so much more conflict, so much more turmoil, it started to be a bigger sore, would he have stopped preaching his gospel? No, but what I believe Paul wanted, because again, his gospel came from God and the heart of God, is that we would have unity in our fellowship. That we would have unity in our church. But now be careful, because sometimes the world tells us that we achieve unity by appeasement, right? That we only, you know, hey, we want to be unified, so let's make sure we don't do the things that this person doesn't like and the thing that that person doesn't like. Let's make sure we do something that everybody can agree on. And while we're searching for our whole lives to find something that everybody can agree on, God is screaming at us and saying, the gospel is something we must all agree on. That's what brings unity. Paul wanted to make sure that what he was doing was certainly from God. He needed it to be corroborated. He is in the Spirit, that he is following in obedience, and he is doing what he's called to do. And if that was going to cause so much strife that it would detract from the church and detract from God's glory and detract from the work of his kingdom, he didn't want that. He wanted to see people united around the gospel. The things that he was doing, the things that he was preaching, were very different than what the people in Jerusalem were used to. They took out all the Jewish tradition of it and got to the meat, got to the bare bones of the gospel that God had given. Same gospel that saved those in Jerusalem, by the way, but without all the extra add-ons. Paul didn't want to cause trouble here, but he also wasn't willing to bend what he was saying, to be disobedient to God, so that he could please people. He wanted to make sure that his change in how he shared the gospel was right. You and I need to make sure that when we do something, when we're stepping out and saying we're doing something for God, desiring to do something in His will, desiring to obey Him in service or in action or in word or whatever, we need to make sure that it's right. How do we know it's right? Well, it's right if it doesn't hack a lot of people off. No. Can we just agree that the gospel's been hacking people off since it's been around? Jesus has been, forgive the colloquialism, but he's been hacking people off for a long time. People who believe the lie are offended by the truth. It's not about whether or not everybody agrees and likes it. It's about whether or not we're based in truth. That's what we're talking about this morning. We say our change must be right. Paul wanted to make sure that the race he was running was right under the Lord so that it would build his church, unify his church around what mattered, not around traditions that had been built around the things that matter. He said in verse 3, he says, yet not even Titus, who was with me, was compelled to be circumcised even though he was a Greek. So in this back and forth, in this discussion, it would have been a potential situation or a potential outcome here that Titus would have said, you know what? I've heard from these people in Jerusalem. I'm a Greek believer. I'm not Jewish. I'm not circumcised, so I should probably get circumcised. But what we see here is that God worked in the hearts of the people in that meeting. God worked in the hearts of those men, those leaders, and there was nothing to compel, and especially the Holy Spirit did not compel Titus to do anything different than follow the gospel that God had shared with him through Paul. Now in verse 4, we see kind of human nature at work. We see the way we as people are tempted to work if we're not careful. In verse 4, it said, this matter arose because some false believers had infiltrated our ranks to spy on the freedom we have in Christ Jesus and to make us slaves. The people who believe the lie hate the truth, right? They're offended by the truth. They don't like the truth. It hacks them off, right? This is exactly what was happening. In that meeting, some people who had come in and who had been admitted into this meeting were there with false motives. In fact, they are called in other translations false brothers, which is not a good term. False believers in what we've read this morning, again, not a good term. False meaning not true, not legitimate, not authentic. False believers, they had snuck in to see what this was all about so that, not so that they could find out what God was doing, but so that they could work their will into the situation. And as Paul says, take them out of the freedom they had in Christ and bring them back to being slaves to rules, to laws, to traditions. Paul says to the churches at Galatia, he says, look, but we, in verse 5, did not give in to them for a moment so that the truth of the gospel, not Paul's gospel, but the gospel he preached that comes straight from God, might be preserved for you. If Paul was so adamant that they didn't give in for a minute when he's meeting with the leaders of the faith, shouldn't we be as adamant in our personal lives that we would stay true to God's gospel? We'll say, Rich, well, how do I know what God's gospel is? pick it up. It's right here. You say, okay, so which part? The Gospels? No, well, that's what we call the first four books of the New Testament because they do share the story of Jesus. But from start to finish, from front to back, and everywhere in between, we see the story that sets up Jesus, that presents Jesus, that honors Jesus, and all the way through, all of that's going on. Do you want to know what the real gospel is? Don't listen to what somebody else says. Definitely don't just listen to what I say. Pick it up. Study it, learn it, pray over it, meditate in it. Let God teach you. It's okay to hear other people. It's okay to hear preachers of all kinds, of all shapes and sizes, denominations, understandings and backgrounds. That's fine. But make sure it comes back to this right here. If it doesn't come back to this right here, there is no other option that will please the Lord. So when we say, well, I know what the Bible says, but stop right there, because whatever comes next is not good. Doesn't matter what you've done, doesn't matter what we've experienced, doesn't matter what is easier or what makes more people happy. If it doesn't line up with right here, it's not honoring God. There's no way around that. Paul wanted to make sure that he was doing the things that honor God. We need to make sure that our change is right, that it's in the Lord, from the Lord, for the Lord. We pick up in verse 6 and it says, as for those who were held in high esteem, talking about the leaders, whatever they were makes no difference to me. God does not show favoritism. They added nothing to my message. On the contrary, they recognized that I had been entrusted with the task of preaching the gospel to the uncircumcised, just as Peter had been to the circumcised. For God, who was at work in Peter as an apostle to the circumcised, was also at work in me as an apostle to the Gentiles. James, Cephas, and John, those esteemed as pillars, gave me and Barnabas the right hand of fellowship when they recognized the grace given to me. They agreed that we should go to the Gentiles, and they to the circumcised. All they asked was that we should continue to remember the poor, the very thing I'd been eager to do all along. When our change is right, change allows us to be different. Now that sounds pretty profound, doesn't it? Probably not. Change makes us different. Okay, well, yeah, that's what change is. It's to have something different come about or to be made different or become different. What we're talking about here is, sure, change makes me different than I was. That's change, right? But the right change that comes with God and from God, with faith in Christ through salvation, that comes from the gospel, it allows us to be different even if we don't always see things or approach things the exact same way. We know the truth. We are based in the truth. Our living out of the truth might look different. And certainly we see that here. Paul didn't want to run his race. He didn't want to have been running or be running his race in vain. And so he's looking forward to the response. Not so he can find his validation from people, but so that he can see that God is at work here by bringing unity. So in verse 6 it says, as for those that were held in high esteem, he reiterates that he's not just looking for their approval. He's not trying to make them happy. If he had been doing that, it would have been a totally different presentation he'd have given to them. He says, hey, whatever they were makes no difference to me. Does that mean he doesn't respect them? No. It just means that they're not God. It just means that they're people just like he is, called by God, and God's not going to call us to operate in different truths. God's going to call us to operate in His truth. God's not going to call us to be serving different Jesuses, even if the way we do serve the same Jesus might look a little different. He says, God does not show favoritism. And folks, let's make sure we understand that this morning. Whether you believe you to be a leader in this church or far from a leader in this church or somewhere in between, God doesn't show favoritism. We've got great deacons, we've got great Sunday school teachers, we've got great, all kinds of different leaders in our churches, but not a one of them is loved more by God than the person who is out on the streets, never been to church. God does not show favoritism. God has willed and desires that all would come to salvation through faith in Christ. And even once we are saved, He still doesn't show favoritism. Well, I do this, I'm more important. No, you're not. It's kind of like I was talking to one of the girls the other day and they were talking about having done something, and I'm always proud of what they do. Well, I'm mostly always proud of what they do, just like they're mostly always proud of what I do. And I was joking. I was like, that would be like me congratulating you for remembering to breathe every day. So this morning, if we want to base like how God should look at us on what we've done, if we've, what we've done is godly, well, good. That's what we should be doing, right? If Jesus has truly done what he says he does when he saves us and we're actually saved, then we should be in church leading and serving. We should be in the Word growing and stretching our understanding. Let him teach us more and more. We should be taking out the things in our life that are unholy and growing in the things that are holy. We should be changing. That doesn't earn us favor with God. That shows that we're saved. So it's not about, you know, people want to say, well, I've been at this church for this many years. Good. That's where you should have been if you're saved and God's put you here. That doesn't mean that you're better than the person who just showed up. Doesn't mean I can say I've been pastor here for X many years, I preached this many sermons. Great. That's exactly what God called me to do. You know, we've got, you know, sports that we love to watch, and there's all kinds of excessive celebration going on in every sport, right? Man, act like you've been there before is what the old coach said. Act like you've been there before. You score the touchdown, well, hey, that's what you plan to do. Don't act surprised that you got in the end zone. You hit the home run, don't be surprised. I mean, that's what you were trying to do when you swung the bat. We shouldn't act like God shows favoritism based on what we do. We should simply be obedient. And Paul's saying, look, it's not about impressing the big wigs. They're doing what they're supposed to do. I'm doing what I'm supposed to do. If we're both following God, then we're going to do right. He says, they added nothing to my message. They didn't change it. He says in verse 7, on the contrary, they recognize that I have been entrusted with the task of preaching to the gospel to the uncircumcised, just as Peter had been to the circumcised. Here's what they learn. Here's what God shows them in the Holy Spirit in that meeting. That, hey, the gospel's the same, but the way we present it might be a little different based on our audience. And God's big enough to handle that. God, as He changes us, as He grows us, as He matures us, is growing us to allow us to be different. Why? So that we can do our thing and somebody else can do their thing? No! So that more people will be reached. So that more people will hear the gospel, see the gospel, experience the gospel, and accept the gospel. We know this morning that we are a great crowd in here. We've got some great looking folks and we're all a little bit different. We look different, we dress different, we act different, we talk different, all these things. But sadly, if we look around, we're not the best picture, the best cross-section of our community. Why? Because there's some people that live in our community that we are called to love and minister to that on their own, unless God leads them, aren't coming through that door. And so when we preach the gospel in our services, as we do and as we should, that's great. But we've also got to be preaching the gospel in a different looking way, same gospel, in the community. Boy, times like we're experiencing in our community right now, times of grief and loss and fear and the things we go through, we don't want to say that we're going to leverage them. That's a terrible way to look at it, but it's a great time to share the hope of God through the gospel. It's a great time to share the comfort of God. The fact that even though we are experiencing loss and fearing more loss, that we can share about Jesus who's overcome it all. Paul says, look, God showed me I'm not running my race in vain. Because in that, and he reiterates in verse 8, he says, look, Peter was supposed to be called to the circumcised and me to the uncircumcised, and God was at work in both. He's saying change allows us to be different and still be in the kingdom. Not to be divided in our fellowship, but to understand what God's called us to do and be about that. Now that doesn't mean, oh, well, God's saying I do this. We go back to, doesn't line up right here. If you say that God's, or I say that God's calling me or you to do something that's not in here, He's not. We don't have to wrestle with it. We don't have to pray about it. We don't have to seek counsel about it because there's our counsel right there to start off and it's literally black and white on the page. We don't need to search deeper into that. If it's spoken against in here, the case is closed. We might still wrestle. We might still struggle, but the truth has been stated. He says, look, James, Cephas, and John, those esteemed as pillars, what'd they do? Did they say, hey, okay, whatever, you just do your thing, we'll do our thing? No. He says, they gave him, Paul, and Barnabas the right hand of fellowship. Now, we shake hands with a lot of people that we may not have good, godly fellowship with, right? We shake hands with a lot of people throughout the day in the work world, school, whatever, and maybe it's not a handshake, maybe it's a high five or dap or whatever it may be, right? But whatever we do that symbol of, hey, man, we're together. Hey, lady, we're together. What he's saying is they give him and Barnabas the acceptance. Not that they have in people, but they're saying, look, we believe that God has called you to do what you're doing. We believe that God has given you the gospel that leads people to Jesus, just as what we're preaching does. They have that right hand of fellowship. And then they recognize, he said in the middle of verse 9, the grace given to Paul. And they said they agreed that they should go to the Gentiles and spread the gospel there, and they would continue spreading the gospel there in Jerusalem amongst the Jews. The gospel allows us to change, and that change allows us to be different. He said all they asked was that we remember the poor, and what was the occasion for them being in Jerusalem? Was to deliver the offering that would go to the poor. They were both about that, and they should be, and so should we. We skip ahead now to verse 19, but the parts we skip are the meat of the message from a few weeks ago at the end of the Disappearance of Me series. And we talk about where Paul says, hey, I looked at Cephas, I looked at Peter, and I said, look, this is an issue. And so they got this stuff, with the right hand of fellowship, they got this stuff worked out. And to conclude that meeting, to conclude this part of his defense of the gospel that he has preached faithfully to the churches in Galatia and that they should not walk away from, he comes back to this. In verse 19, he says, for through the law, I died to the law so that I might live for God. I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I now live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not set aside the grace of God, for if righteousness could be gained through the law, Christ died for nothing. Can I just tell you a simple truth this morning? It's probably its own sermon. Christ, Jesus, the one true Jesus, Christ means more than us. You say, oh, wait a minute, that's kind of uncomfortable. We don't like to talk about people, one person mattering more than the other. Well, we're not talking about me mattering more than you or you mattering more than me. We already know that God doesn't show favoritism. But Christ means more than us. That's true in an individual sense. As we've talked about this morning, as you'll hear us talk about from this stage anytime you're in here, what Christ is calling us to do is greater than what we want to do on our own. And it always will be. It'll always be right what Christ calls us to do truly. And what we want to do, if it's different than that, will always be wrong. When you think about it collectively, Christ and His kingdom means more than Harrisville Baptist Church and our little kingdom here. It means more than what we've done or what we want to do. It means more than what we're doing now. It means more than what we've built. It means more than our bank accounts or our buildings or all other things that we might think are the big thing. Christ means more than us. What does He say there in the last three verses of the passage? He tells us, He says, look, it's not about me. Even though He's made this defense and they've come out on the same side, on God's side, through faith in Jesus Christ and the power of the Holy Spirit, they've come out in agreement that they should keep doing what they're doing in Jerusalem and Paul should keep doing what he's doing as he goes and is led elsewhere. And the faith continues to grow. They have the right hand of fellowship. And He says, look, we do this because it's about more than the law. He says, through the law, I died to the law so I might live for God. What that tells us is that if we're focused on living by the law, we're missing out on living for God. Does that mean the law is not important? Does that mean the rules and things that are taught in it aren't from God? No, but they've been completed in Christ. He says, through the law, I died to the law so that I might live for God. He says, I've been crucified. Does he mean literally that he's been put on a cross? No. Paul would die in a different way. Some of the other apostles, not so they would actually be physically crucified. What he's talking about is his life has been crucified. His desire for his own good and for his own way has been crucified. His individuality has been crucified so that he can line up with who Jesus is and what he's called him to be. He says, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. It's not about what I want to do. Christ means more than us. Christ means more than me. It's about what he wants to do through me. He says, the life I now live in the body, I live by leaning on what I've accomplished and what I've experienced and what I know. No. I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. It's about Jesus. He says, I don't set aside the grace of God, because if righteousness could be gained by following rules or obeying tradition, then Christ died for nothing. This morning, Christ did not die for nothing. He died so that God would be glorified in all his creation. And the only way that could happen is if you and I, people like me and you, people like people, could be saved. That's how far off we are in sin, that Christ had to die for that to be able to be made true, for that to be able to be made possible, for that to come to pass. This morning, Christ died not just for everybody, but for you as an individual as well. You're part of that everybody. If you've not put your faith in him, the truth of the matter is, you're living for you. You may be trying to live a God-like life. You can't say a godly life, because godly life honors Christ and surrenders to him. But you could probably be living a God-like life where you do some Christian-type things, and that's great, except it doesn't save you, because Christ wouldn't have died, as Paul's just written here, if you could do it that way. If you've not put your faith in Jesus yet, you're living it your way. But you don't have to keep doing that. And whether you're watching at home this morning or whether you're sitting here in the sanctuary in the same seat you've sat in for a long time, today can be the day where he sets you free. Free from trying to do it on your own, free from trying to be your own God, because we make pitiful gods. Free from trying to have to deal with everything before a holy God with your unholy self. He will redeem you. He will forgive you if you will give him your life. He's already given his life for you. I would implore you this morning, if you've not put your faith in Jesus, would today be the day? If you're a Christian this morning, if you have put your faith in Jesus, but you find yourself being divided and distracted by the things you want to do, or maybe the things that make a few people around you happy, or maybe the things you think make everybody around you happy. If it's not truly based on God's word, if it's not truly based on the freedom he's given you through the precious sacrifice of Jesus Christ, he's calling you to change this morning. It doesn't have to be a whole big brouhaha about the thing. It can be as simple as this. God, I know where I've been. God, you know where I've been. I'm yours, I know that, I'm saved, but bring me back to where you want me. Bring me back to chasing after the things you say are important, not the things that I've built up in my mind and my heart that I think are important. Bring me back to know that Christ means more than me. If you're a Christian this morning, maybe it's about coming back to him and just saying, man, I've misplaced my priorities. Forgive me, Lord, and he will. You'd be amazed how he'll change you in your family, in your business, right here in your church, and in your life. When we all start looking towards Christ above all else. If there's something else on your heart, certainly if you want to come and pray at this altar this morning for Justin, for Mr. Wayne Lemon's family, for anyone who's hurting, you are free to do that this morning as you are every Sunday. This time of invitation is God simply saying, I want to do business. What that business is between you and him. Would you do business with God this morning? Let's go to him as we wrap up. Father God, we thank you this morning that you love us and that you still do business with us. Lord God, on a morning where we've gone a little longer than we usually do, Father God, we believe that it's simply because you had things to say to each heart. So Lord God, right now, would you let us respond in like kind? As you have worked in us, let us surrender ourselves to you for the first time in a while. Father, whatever you're calling us to do, let us surrender to you even now as we move, as we let you do business, and as we do business with you. Father, receive us as we give our lives to you, as we put our lives back in your care and acknowledge you to be our Lord. In all of it, Lord, be glorified as we worship you now through our response. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Please stand. To Jesus I surrender, all to him I freely give, I will ever love and trust him in his presence daily.
Father, I pray for the families that had lost loved ones. Just lift them up, Father, as only you can, Father, and just give them peace and comfort through this trying time. Father, I just continue asking you to continue to bless this church. We thank you for the week that we had last week with Vacation Bible School, Father. I just pray that the seed was planted for these young people, Father, and just one day it'll come to fruition. Father, bless this portion of our church. Forgive us where we fail you, Father. In your own name we pray. Amen.
Ministry Spotlight this morning. First, want to tell you about the arrangements. If you didn't see them through our text messages or through Facebook yesterday evening, we got the final arrangements in from Mr. Wayne Lemon. His service will be here at our church tomorrow afternoon. Visitation will start at 1 p.m. I think the family's going to get here about 12, about noon or so. But visitation for family and friends will come at 1 p.m. and go to 3 p.m. and the service will begin at 3 with interment to be across the street. And then we will be serving a meal. So if you'd like to bring a dish, please bring that by the fellowship hall. You don't have to bring it by super early in the morning unless you need to. Just let one of the folks on the hospitality committee know so that we can make sure to have it open for you. The church office will be open tomorrow, so if it's after 9, you can just come on and bring it to the church office and we can get it there for you. But continue to support the family there. Miss Noreen? Is it news? I'm sorry, I said that wrong. I apologize. But anyway, this funeral will be here. And the meal will come back and be here as well. We do have something this afternoon that we want to invite as many to you as are led to come to be a part of. You've heard us talk about Summer Blast. It's going to be that July 15th event that will welcome our community onto our campus and that will hopefully reach out and minister to them through having a lot of fun for all ages. This is not a children's event. This is not a youth event. This is not a senior adult event. This is a church event, right? So it's neat. We need people from all of those areas to be a part of helping us plan this so we can get that angle on things. If you don't come be a part of the planning, we can't read your mind from afar, right? So come help us plan these things so that we can reach out to our community. It's going to be part of what we hope will become 4 annual events that we'll do each year that'll be a part of adding to the extravaganza and our fall activities as well around Halloween. So we're excited about this. At 4 o'clock this afternoon, come on into the church office down here, and we'll meet in the conference room there and continue the planning process for Summer Blast. We want to hear from you. We've reached out to a few different committee chairmen to make sure that they are aware and they can get either, if they can come, that's awesome. If they can bring people from the committee or send people from their committee in their stead, that's fine. Either way, we're trying to get every committee we can involved with this. So if you didn't get a personalized invitation, you're getting one now, all right? So come on and be a part of Summer Blast planning this afternoon. We look forward to seeing you at 4, and then we've got our regular services this evening beginning at 5 and going on. I think there's a youth camp meeting that Steele will tell you about in just a second on my way out, but a lot of stuff going on here. Continue to pray for the Lemmings. Continue to pray for the Bottoms, and let's continue to pray for one another as well. We hope you have a great rest of the afternoon. We look forward to seeing you back here this evening.
Like Brother Rich said, we will have a youth parent meeting at 5:30. Your kids will already be here. We'll have about a 20-minute lesson, so be here. So we're inviting all the parents to just come a little early, and we got forms to fill out. Miss Ethel's going to grace us with her presence and our nice little notary thing for stuff we need notarized. So if you need stuff notarized, please be here. If you have a kid going to camp, please be here. Amen? Woo! Amen? All right. Yes, Noreen. Yeah, baby shower for Lauren Berry at 2. For those that can make it, please come to that. Yay. All right. If y'all would, please stand. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by His blood. And join in with Jesus as we travel this side. For I'm a part of the family of God.